Just as usual, I'll start with some announcements. The grades are on the website, so you can log in and check your grades for each assignment, for midterm, for any future work that gets done in this course, you'll be able to check the grade. So once you sign in, you have to just type in your student number, and then an email will be sent to your registered McMaster email address. That's a link that you get, and you can go log in, and the link just works once. So there's no need to log in and log out and set passwords and all that junk. Use the link, and you can see your grades. You can do this as many times as you like. So what it will show you is, here, for example, for assignment one, this person, the question one, got an alpha, the grading was 1-1, so in other words, there was 1 mark for 400 students, 1 mark for 600 students. Like, for example, the contrast has a question 6 where 400 students didn't have to do that, so that gets a 0 over there. So we've got an alpha, beta, beta, and then a gamma for question 5. The reason why I put this up here is some people said that they found the marking system a little confusing, which is true if you want to calculate this number yourself, the final percentage yourself. But the reason why I've used alpha, beta, and gamma is it's just easier for the TA. It's very clear from your side then where the understood the material or not. So it's kind of a very committed marking system. There's no half a grade here, half a grade there. But to calculate your final percentage, sure, it's a little bit confusing, so that's another reason why I put this website up. And secondly, you can use it just to verify that the grades are reported accurately. The last column then shows how the rest of the class performed. So in this first question, most people got alpha, the three people betas, and then NA stands for not answered. So it kind of gives you a feel of where you stand relative to the rest of the class. Okay. Another announcement is for 600 level students and those taking classes in the School of Engineering Practice, that there's some extra classes available at the end of this course, 4 additional classes, which continue on the multivariate data analysis section. So for the multivariate data analysis section, you'll see when we get to it, I'll just do 3 weeks. Actually, more like two classes, and then about half the class on just some applications. But it's not nearly enough to kind of cover the full extent of what multivariate methods can do for you. So the School of Engineering Practice has asked me to teach some additional classes, and the university's policy is that if that's happening, that everyone can come to it. So if you do have time available, this is during exam time though, you're more than welcome to attend. So I'll let you know later on when the dates and times are. There won't be any assignments for grade or anything like that. It's purely just if you want to see more of what multivariate methods can do. And this is an area that I've worked in for a number of years, so hopefully I can bring a few more professional case studies to show you a bit more about what goes on. Then lastly, I'll talk a bit about the very small project that's only worth 10% of the grade of this course, and it's on this design experiment. So I'll talk about it that at the end of the class, and you can kind of better understand what the project will be about after you've seen it. Okay, so the last class on these squares and this class on design experiments, they really have a very similar theme in the sense that all of this is about the empirical modeling of the system. So this may be very different to what you're used to in Chem Eng. You're probably used to your reactor design course, thermodynamics course, mass balance courses, where you come in and say, this is the known model of how the system behaves. And you derive reaction kinetics, and you use that to design the plug flow reactor size, and you use that to in thermodynamics to calculate all sorts of interesting concepts. So it's kind of the, what we're going to do is the opposite approach. In those courses, you say, this is the equation of the system. This is what you expect. You plug in some numbers and you get an answer. With this part of the course, we work the other way around. We collect data from our system, and we say, look, the reality is too complicated to model. We don't know the reaction constants. We don't know the 3 or 4 competing reactions going on and their interactions with each other. We don't know the heat transfer and the thermodynamics and the coefficients in the heat exchanger related to heat transfer. We don't know any of that. What we do know is the data we collect from the system, the temperatures, pressures, flow rates, the inputs and the outputs. What we're going to do is build empirical models. So the theoretical models are the ones that you've learned about up to now, probably in Cambridge. Now we're looking at empirical models, black box models, gray box models. But the generic term empirical models describes it nicely because we're using empirical data and we're building a model just for that system. So the model is valid for that particular time and system that you collected the data for. It's not necessarily valid on a totally new system. Collecting the data on your plant in Sarnia doesn't necessarily mean you can transfer it over to your plant in Houston and expect it to work. It's only for the system that you collected it off. Okay? We'll talk a bit about later how you can transfer models, but initially just bear in mind that the models you build here are applied to just that local system. Okay, so we'll use experiments then to move the system around and be able to build a better model. Whereas in the last class, we just said, here's some data from the system. We don't know how they were collected. We just got that data, we built a linear model, and we interpret the coefficients, we interpret the predictions from those models. In this class, we're going to learn, how do you manipulate the system in order to build better models and learn from them? The converse of that is what's called happenstance data, which just adds this data. This is the majority of the data from the system. If you go to any plant, Petro-Canada, Sarnia, GlaxoSmithKline, and Mississauga, they've got these huge databases, gigabytes, that get filled up daily with just plant data. There's nothing intentionally designed about those data. They just happen to be collected from the system at that time. We'll call that happenstance data, and we'll learn how to treat that in the last session of this course. But for this part of the course, we're going to deal with how do you manipulate the system. So just some examples here are where your colleague says, we know we've got these eight factors that affect melt index, but where do we begin to work with them? How do we narrow them down to a smaller number that we can deal with? Which one has the greatest effect on the melt index? Presumably, you want to optimize for a particular melt index value, or you want to achieve some goal with this. But you've got this eight factors that you've identified. How can you reduce that down to a smaller number? Then you come down to, say, three factors, temperature, flow rate, and impurity concentration, for example. How do you now run your experiments to understand the effect and why? Or you may just have, in this third example here, where you've got an existing experimental data set, how do you optimize the process? So in the assignments, you just won't have the chance to go into how the data was collected. We'll just kind of start at the point, here's the data set from an experiment, analyze it. Then lastly here is, and this is where we'll end up with this section of DLE, is when things happen on a process, and this is true for many processes actually, you operate kind of on a knife edge, is usually where you get your best operation. Like on the edge of the cliff is usually where you get your highest yield, the best quality product, but it's also the most unstable point. Small perturbations in your raw materials and your operating conditions lead you towards the cliff. So can we find other operating points that give us similar quality product and still get similar results but maybe in a safer way? So we're not subject to this movements in the process that make us unstable. So we'll talk a bit about that robustness concept in the next class. Okay, then just as usual, one of these diagrams that shows where we're going with this section. We'll talk a bit about randomization today. I'll leave blocking and replicates to the next class. And then this is the section we'll focus on today, primarily with factorial designs. If you want to read up about this outside the course notes, I strongly suggest you grab a copy of Box Hunter and Hunter. It's on reserve in the library, so get chapters 5 and 6, which is where this material comes from. There's a tutorial on the web, and then just to acknowledge that a lot of the structure and some of the concepts come from John Mayer's who taught this course for many years. Okay, so I'll just cover this system of experiments with a single variable. This is purely a recap of last time and it was taken away. So what happens in this case? We're doing an experiment where there's only one variable, and it's at two levels. So You've seen this over and over. You've got catalyst A or catalyst B, or you've got raw material A or raw material B. You want to understand which one is better. So the way the experiments go is you take NA values from system A, and you measure NB values from system B, and you guarantee in some way that all the other variables are constant in order to control for disturbances. And you can do that by blocking, or you can do that by randomization or pairing. So we've done this in the previous course, and you saw this in the midterms, for example, A was the radial impeller and B was the axial impeller. You kept everything else constant, you collected your Y values, and now you want to analyze the data. Okay? So you compute the pool variance, you compute the Z value, and then the confidence interval. And the way we interpret it is if this confidence interval spans zero, approximately symmetrically, then we say there's no effect between A and B. Or if there's an unevenness, asymmetry in that confidence interval, or it's all positive or all negative, then we know that the true difference between system B and system A is significant, whatever confidence level we use. So we're all comfortable with that one. Yeah.
What did you use a third
test? Okay, so pairing is another way to do it. The only reason why I'm not talking about it right now is I'll talk about it in the next class. But pairing is the same principle. Pairing, the only difference is pairing is says we sometimes can't hold all the variables constant, so we're going to pair on one object and then just compute the differences within it and then calculate their confidence. It's the same experimental setup. We've got A and B, but it's to account for some inequality in the system that we pair. So for example, drug trials are things that are paired. So you'll have one person take a drug for a few weeks on drug A, give them a break, and then they continue on with drug B. So you know that drug A works differently on me than it does on someone else, but because you paired it on me and you paired it on the other people, you're canceling out the fact that maybe I've got bad genes and someone else has good genes. So, yeah, we'll talk a bit about pairing and locking in the next class. Okay, now this is actually quite interesting. If you build a linear model in R or whatever tool you like, where Y is equal to V0 plus G times DR. So this says our measurement, our response, Y. So say for example, we're going to use this idea of that reactor brittleness that we used in the assignments, the TK104, TK105, 107. Remember we were measuring the brittleness from the reactor, that was our Y variable. Our change was the fact that we ran it in reactor A or reactor B, or TK104, TK107. I'm just going to call it A and B for this class. If you build a linear model where YI equals some intercept plus the term for this integer variable and DI. So DI is the on-off variable, so it's yes or no, or it's reactor A or reactor B, or drug A or drug B. You just code it as 0, 1. So you build up a data set where you have a column here and you set A or B, and maybe you have A, B, A. And here you have the Y variable of interest. So maybe this is 400, this is 320, this is 600, and this is 550. Okay, and so on. You keep going, collecting the Y values. You can plug those two columns into R and say, build me a linear model where Y is described by this factored variable, A and B. Okay, and then the coefficient, G, gives you a measure of changing from 0 to 1. So A is coded as 0 and B is coded as 1. So the coefficient G will tell you the effect on Y when you change from system A to system B. Okay? This is in exactly the same way of doing the same thing as we did earlier by instead of using those this previous equation where you have to pull the variance and you calculate the z value, you can calculate g and then calculate the confidence interval on g, and you'll get exactly the same result. So to me that was pretty neat the first time I did it, because I was like, wow, the first option where you calculate the pooled variance, you're first calculating the variance of the y values, then you're pooling them, then you're calculating a z value, and then you're calculating the confidence interval for z. In the second method here, you're calculating a linear model, you're calculating the standard error for g, and the confidence interval comes out to be exactly the same. So two different methods, exactly the same interpretation. So just, it's another way to look at the same problem. One is using least squares and one is using this idea of error. So I'll leave it up to you to confirm. This result was on TK104 versus TK107, so you can just go back to this assignment question. Now I'll leave you to confirm that it works for 105 and 107, compare 104 to 105. So to me that's pretty interesting that you can get the same interpretation using a totally different approach. Okay, so maybe we'll just take a break here before I go on to randomization. And then let's say 10 minutes or so. Just a question came up during the break about the grading. I just want to point out that actually what's happened here with the in-class quiz is the 5% bit. I'm just kind of giving that everyone 5%. That's kind of my makeup to you for the hard midterm on set. So everyone is kind of 5%.
I've already done well on that. Actually,
9.8. I know, it was pretty okay, so let's move on to... So in this, what I just want to point out here with this section is the importance of randomization and why we always talk about randomization. I didn't mention this in some of the previous classes, but it's just worth recapping. And I'm going to show you a different view on randomization that maybe you haven't thought of. Not my position, it's actually something by Fisher, famous statistician. So let's just take a look here. We randomize experiments to overcome the fact that we know we cannot keep everything constant. If you're on a plant environment and you're making a change in your process, say you're doing an experiment to test a new raw material, so you're looking at raw material A versus material B, and you decide you're going to run your plant experiment with material A on Monday, and you're going to do B on Tuesday. Okay. So when you put raw material A into your system on Monday, your process, the other process variables are at a particular state, and you're trying to keep them constant. So let's take a look, for example, at perhaps the ambient temperature. So the temperature in the air on that day. And so it's to like it's today, it's 7-8 degrees outside. So Monday, the temperature is around 7 degrees, 8 degrees. And then it maybe drops a little bit over the evening. Now Tuesday comes and you put in your raw material B. And Tuesday morning has to be a particular cold day, so the temperature on Tuesday is minus 5. Okay? And then you get your measurements at the end. And you say to your boss, you know, raw material B works really well. Now, it's not necessarily then because of material B. It could have been the ambient temperatures because the two things changed at the same time. So A and B, we say, was correlated with the ambient temperature. So you cannot decorrelate the data because it's already occurred. It's built into your data set. On the other hand, if you randomize, then you break this correlation. The way you randomize is simply saying you're going to run A for part of the day, then B, then go another run of B, then A, then B, and maybe A again. So you've got three runs of A, three runs of B, And by randomizing the order and not doing three sequential runs of A and three sequential runs of B, we've broken that correlation, that unintended correlation between ambient temperature and the raw material. So that's the one way we can break that, is by randomizing. So it guarantees our independence in the data, and it prevents these unmeasured or sometimes uncontrollable disturbances. And I'll prove to you now, it means that if we randomize and we have independence, remember that was a requirement in order to use the two distributions, which we then use to calculate the conicalism. So there's this example of Fisher, who in the 1920s was invited to a tea party in England, and this lady came and said she can tell the difference when the tea is added to the milk or the milk is added to the tea. And Fisher says, I don't believe you. So the lady says, no, I can tell the difference between the fact when you've added the milk first or the tea first. So Fisher then uses that, whether he actually did the experiments with the lady or not is not really material, but this inspired him to this idea where you would create N experiments, or N cups of tea, some added the milk first, some with the tea first, and he shows then, uses ideas of randomization, how you can tell whether the lady is really capable of making this distinction, or whether it was by pure chance that she got this right. So I'll show you on an engineering example rather than tea and milk. We'll talk about back to reactive A and B, or TK104 and TK107. I mean, a modern day equivalent of that would be to try and get your housemates or your partner, someone to tell the difference between Coke and Pepsi. You pour four glasses of Coke, four glasses of Pepsi, randomize them, and then see if they can tell the difference. Of course, you need to make sure that you don't do things like put the Coke in a blue cup and a Pepsi in a red cup, because then you've got another variable that's correlated exactly with Coke and Pepsi. You need to do a blind test where there's absolutely no difference to the subject's perspective of whether they're receiving Coke or Pepsi. It's the same reason why we use placebos as well. The placebo is made identical looking to the actual drug. There's no way for the user to tell the difference. So that's a modern day version of lady and a tea. Let's take a look at an engineering example. So the way that this concept of randomization goes is as follows. So just bear with me. It might seem a little weird at first, but let's take a look at this. So in the original data set, there were about 20 measurements on A and 23 on B. I'm just going to use 8 and 9 again. And you'll see why in a minute. So the way it goes is it says, we collect these 8 measurements from run material A in reactor A. So we're putting the material A, putting the material in reactor A, in other words, TK14. We're putting the same material in reactor B, and we're calculating these brittleness values. The null hypothesis is there's no difference between the reactors, right? So what this setup is actually doing, we're putting the same material into the two reactors. What we're really doing here is we're testing the difference between the reactors. Is there an effect between the two reactors? So if the null hypothesis is no effect, these numbers that we collected from A could have been equally likely to have come from system B and the other way around. In fact, I can reshuffle that entire vector around because it would make no difference if the null hypothesis is that there is no difference.
Sorry, are we testing the difference between A and B or the difference between the reactors?
Yeah, I've coded A as 104 and D as tank 107. So what this experiment is doing, we're putting the same material into two different reactors, running them and comparing brittleness values. So yes, you're right, the test is to assess if there's a difference between reactors. Yeah. So given the null hypothesis that there is no difference, these numbers could have been from either system, right? They're equally likely from any system. Okay? In other words, I can make one long vector of these numbers and assign A and B randomly to any of the values. As long as I assign 8 values of A and 9 values of B, because that's the data, right? So 8 measurements from A, 9 from B. So I can, the data as it stands here is of course A, and then B for those last 9 measurements. So let me just take a look at that here. If I just ignore this middle part for now, The coding would be A is 254, A belongs to 440, A belongs to 501, all the way up to 525. Then B belongs to 338, B is 470, up to 517. That's the actual data we collected, and that would be the coding for that experiment. This is the actual experiment that did occur. How many combinations are there of shuffling this data around? So randomly assigning A to NA of the values and B to NB of the values, and in this case NA is 8 and NB is 9. So we're asking, what are the number of unique ways to split these 17 experiments into two groups so that there's 8 A's and 9 B's? The answer is given by that factorial ratio. There's 24,000 different ways of shuffling that data uniquely. And the first way I've shown here is the way that you actually did collect the data. But remember, the null hypothesis is that these data could have come from either A or B. We're saying we want to test if there's a difference. Our initial assumption is there is no difference. So the second way you could shuffle this data is you just interchange these two. So now you say that brittleness value came from reactor B, and that brittleness value came from reactor A. That's what the second row is saying. And the third one just keeps shoving A around. And then I've got a little computer program that just does all the permutations. And what we do is we calculate the average brittleness for all the A's, the average brittleness for all the B's. We calculate YA minus YB bar for each of those 24,000 shuffles. And we plot a histogram of this difference of averages. Okay. So when Fisher did this with the lady and the tea, he had four cups of tea where the milk was added first, and then the tea on top of the milk, and he had four cups of tea where it was the other way around. So he had eight particular cups, four A's and four NB's, and I don't know what the number of combinations are, but it's a much smaller number, of course. And then he calculated the number of times the lady was right, minus the number of times she correctly identified it or not. And then he can plot a histogram of those and then see what's the probability with which the lady actually has the skill to tell the difference versus the probability that this was purely by chance that she made that decision. In this example here, we're saying, what is the probability that these particular numbers we got in vector A actually were significantly different from the system in vector B? So if I plot the histogram of those 24,000 particular YA minus YB pairs, I'll get that particular shape. So the red line represents the actual experiment, and the histogram represents a summary of all the other 24,000 and so on experiments possible. In this case, there's 79.6% combinations that have a lower difference than what was actually seen. And then if you do the standard test where you use a Z value and calculate the probability that Z is less than that, it's 79.3. So very, very similar. In fact, this is exactly what the t-distribution requires. The t-distribution's assumption is that your data come from independent, in other words, uncorrelated or randomized experiments. So the act of randomization then guarantees us the ability to use this test, which is much simpler than going and constructing all those permutations and calculating histograms and then calculating errors. We can simply go and straight away use this Z value and the T distribution because we're guaranteed by the randomization act our answer is going to be correct. If we don't have this randomization or we don't have independence in our data, we may be misled by the Z values we calculate. Okay, so that's the intention of randomization, is that it makes it much easier to calculate those differences. For example, in this case where, over here, this takes like 5-10 seconds on my computer, but the moment I extend this vector up to the original data set, which had 20 observations for A, 23 for B, I calculated it was going to take me 3 years to calculate that histogram. And that's a very small data set, 20 and 23 observations. So 43 observations, it would take me a long time on this new computer to calculate that. So doing this is much faster. And we can guarantee that that result is accurate, provided we've got randomized systems. Okay, so that's then for background. We've looked at how to do experiments with one variable at a time. Before we head into this, let me just summarize here that what we've done here is we've got a system where we've got y, and then we've checked A or B, and we've calculated values for y, y1, y2, y3, up to some yna plus y plus nb. So we've got na plus nb observations of y, and then we've coded here a, b, b, a, or whatever order you put there. We can use these tools I've shown to then analyze the single factor experiment. It's an experiment in one variable, on or off, A or B, yes, no. If you have a third level, so for example, A, B, C, or you have material A, B, C, so in other words, you've got three variables that are, there's no ranking to them. It's not that A is better than B or better than C. They're unranked variables. It could be operator 1, 2, or 3, or material A, B, C, then this tool won't work for you anymore, okay? And we won't cover this, that tool in this class either. It's called analysis of variance. So if it is of interest to you later on, you can very easily extend these tools here for two variables up to three or four more levels, and that's in any textbook that you, if you're interested in that topic, you're welcome to go read into that, but we're not covering that in this course. So that's just so that you're aware of it. It's called analysis of variance. And then you do things like between groups and within groups, variables, and so on. What we will move on to now, though, is the idea of changing multiple variables and doing experiments with multiple variables. So let me just start with this as background. Here's a system, it's a bioreactor, and we're measuring yield. So the reason why I'm using yield all the time is because it's Y, it's our Y variable, it's yield, it's easy to work with. And we've got two X's, substrate concentration, and then the temperature. The contours I've shown behind here are unknown, of course. In practice, we don't know what these are. We may have a good feeling for what we expect if we increase the substrate and the yield goes down. If we increase the temperature, the yield changes in such and such a way. But in practice, we don't know these two, the true gradients that I've shown here in the background. What we do have, though, imagine you're in a lab or in a plant, and you've been operating the process at that baseline condition for a number of years. So the baseline is 346 Kelvin as your heat, as your temperature, and the substrate concentration is 1.5 grams per liter. You've been getting yields in the order of 63%. Okay? So now your boss comes to you and asks, we'd like to jack up that yield. How do you go about it? If you're on any process, not just this one, and you need to make some sort of improvement, what are the ways you go about it? Well, we make a list of variables that would affect it. Right? So you can put here substrate concentration, temperature, reaction duration. There may be 5, 6, 7, 8 of these variables that you end up listing. And then you do what you do in any good company, you call a meeting. And everyone sits together and gabs away for 5 hours saying, I think temperature is the one. And I think that reaction duration is the other. And they go on and on and on and talk and talk and talk. And that's then. What we're looking at here is then what happens next. Well, what happens next is whoever speaks the loudest says temperature is the one. Okay, so everyone goes away and we decide to run an experiment with temperature. And the person who spoke the loudest says, I know temperature increases yield. So that's the first experiment that goes and gets done. You jack up temperature from 346 up to, say, around 354. And yield drops. Okay, well, maybe there's something about the system that you didn't quite know. So you go the other way. You run your second experiment. And you say, oh, okay, yield has gone up a little bit. So now yield has now gone from 63 up to, say, 66, 67. And you say, well, let's keep going. And it goes to 67. And you keep going a little bit more, and you're like, no, this, we're plateauing here. If you plotted a profile just along that slice of changing temperature but keeping concentration fixed, you would see something like that. And you've started over here, so you've had, so I'm plotting yield on this axis, I'm plotting temperature. So you've moved in this direction and you've kind of started your run over there. You did your first run back this way at lower yield. You've moved up the curve, gone that way. So to your mind, there's no benefit in going any further in temperature. You've kind of said, well, operating at around 330 seems to give me the best yields. In fact, we've never seen yields up at 69. So let's keep it there. Okay, so then the next person says, well, wait a minute, I said in the last meeting substrate concentration has an effect. Let's try that. And your boss says, well, you know, each of these runs cost us $2,500 to do. These $10,000, okay, it's the benefit we've had in improving the yield from 63% up to 69%. That's worth the $10,000. I'm happy to give you another $10,000 to do another 4 experiments. So the guy says, well, let's go do substrate concentration. And then the first run, again, they go higher substrate concentrations. You think that feeding more substrate to the bugs will give a higher yield. Counterintuitively, you learn about something about your process, that no, you've decreased the yield. That's not uncommon. Our preconceptions are often changed by doing actual experiments. And we realize, no, the yield has dropped. So we do the same thing, we go the opposite way. We increase substrate concentration. But we're doing this all the time at the last good temperature we've had, 330. And we start noticing, again, a similar principle. This time it's not yield that's doing it, temperature that's doing it, but it's substrate concentration. So if we plot it again, yield versus substrate S, we started up here at 1.5. And again, a similar profile starts to emerge where we're now going from 69, we maybe get 70, 71, 69 again back. When we get up to here, we get back down to 69%. So again, we think we've plateaued in terms of concentration. And we're happy, right? We've gone from 63% up to 69% yield. This is pretty good for a system where maybe each increase in one yield percent is worth $100,000 a year. So you figure, well, I've optimized my two most influential variables. The group is being adamant. Temperature and substrate concentration are the two variables that have the most influence. They're certain of that. They've worked in the plant for 4 or 5 years. This is their process. They know that by changing these variables, that those are the primary effects on yield. Other effects on yield are smaller.
Let's see that points 5, 3, 6 were all done by the same two lines. So there's no change in yield between 3 and 5, right?
Okay.
Let's say there's no change in yield between 3 and 6.
Enough in yield.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you do the first experiment, you go to 5 and you don't see a change, and then you go down and you don't see a change, what are you gonna do?
Then you stop. Because
7 there's a change.
But you don't know that.
So you stop?
Well, if you've just done 3, and then you do 5, and then you do 6, and then your boss says, well, you've done these 3 experiments, and there's been no change in that variable. But what you don't know these profiles underneath you, of course. So, of course, you stop. Right? That's part of what life is. If you don't know that just on the other side is greener grass, you just don't know that, so you stop. Yeah. And that's very common. We say we've reached this plateau over here, there's no real benefit in changing. It's especially true in cases where, say, the yields were increasing as we went to higher substrate concentration, and there was a flat line. Higher substrate costs you more money. So you especially don't want to operate at the higher value if it's not bringing you anything. Right? So this is very common in plants where you do this one variable at a time type analysis. You change temperature and you keep everything else constant. And you figure out, okay, this is the best temperature set. And now you keep temperature constant and you start changing the other set. Right? But you see what it's done. We've landed up in a suboptimal point. We've landed up over here after our experiments are done. We figured that in terms of temperature and substrate concentration, we've done the best we can do. There's no further improvement possible because from the temperature perspective, we've got the best yield. And from the substrate concentration, we've got the best yield. So this thinking of changing one variable at a time, we call cost. And it's been proven 80, 90 years ago already that it's futile. You will land up in a suboptimal solution. The only time you'll land up in a solution is if, by luck, you stopped at point number two and then kept on going down and down and down. But that's very unlikely to happen, that you stop at point number two and then hit your target optimally. But people do this all the time, and it's, you will see this. We will change this variable and try its effect. When they know that there's three or four other possibilities, they will still just change one variable at a time. I can guarantee you will see this when you leave here and start working, that people will change one variable at a time. Okay, so we get trapped in our suboptimal solution. We've known for many years now that this is the wrong way to do it, so how should we do it? The way you should do it is by changing all the factors all at once. Okay, and this is maybe why it's not done a lot, or not done as often as it should be done. Because the moment you tell someone, change everything, they're like, oh no, I don't know what's going to happen when I change the concentration and temperature to this high new value. It's going to blow up my reactor, or it's going to lead to a lot of a failed product. They're far more comfortable changing one variable at a time. Because it's like, oh well, there's only one thing you did. Then you also say, well, if that improves, I know it was due to that. If you change several things in one go, well, which one was it that caused the improvement? Was it the temperature? Was it the substrate? Or if there was three factors that you were changing here, which of the three was the one that caused it? So there's a lot of resistance to changing multiple factors. But it's what you have to do, and I'll show you now in the rest of the class here today why we have to change multiple factors. So some examples are, and we'll only look at two levels in the factor, so I and low. So I and low, pH, catalyst, A or B, these don't need to be continuous variables. Like in the example I gave was concentration, substrate concentration, temperature. Those were continuous variables. They can be discrete. You can consider the effect of system A versus B, catalyst A versus B, in addition to continuous variables. So you can mix them up, use both types. Okay, so let's take a look at this bioreactor example again. And we'll take a look at what happens now when you do change two variables simultaneously. So we'll call it low and high, minus and plus. So we'll identify the lower level and the higher level of temperature. And we'll talk a bit about in the next class how you might choose those ranges. But typically, you just choose values that's a comfortable step below and above your baseline operation. So for many years you've been operating at 340 some degrees. Well, now you go down 8 Kelvin, you go up 8 Kelvin. So that could be your low and high level for temperature. For concentration, you decide to go 1.25 and 1.75, away from 1.5. So the two factors are temperature and substrate concentration, T and S. And the number of runs for any factorial experiment is 2 to the k. So k is our number of factors. If we had 3, it would be 2 to the 3, we would have 8 experiments to do. With 2 factors, 2 to the 2, we only have to do 4 experiments. temperature low, substrate low, temperature high, substrate low, low, high, high, high. So there's the four combinations, the four corners. I'll illustrate it later on. So if there's three runs, there'll be eight experiments. If there's four factors, you get 16. 2 to the 5 is 32. So you can quickly see how this blows out of proportion a little bit. For systems where you've maybe identified 6-7 factors, this is too many experiments to do. Too many that most managers will not allow you to do. So again, well, I have to defer this to the next class where we talk a bit about screening designs where you can reduce the number of experiments. But for now, we'll focus on these two situations where you've got a manageable size of runs to perform and the analysis of those data. So we'll call this standard order. Standard order is when you write your first factor and you alternate it the fastest. So minus, plus, minus, plus. The next factor is changed one level or changed slope. So minus, minus, plus, plus. If you had three factors, so call them A, B, and C, standard order would be minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, and then that would be minus, minus, plus, plus, and then the last factor changes the slowest. Okay, so that's what standard order means. It's also called Yates disorder, after the statistician Yates. So standard order, we always change by convention. We start with the minus level first. So the first level is all minuses, and we end up with all pluses. And the first factor changes the fastest, the last factor changes the slowest. That's just the way we write the order down. We don't do the experiments in that order. That's important, because if we did the experiments in this order, then we're just going to mess ourselves up. We need to randomize for the same reason I described earlier. For example, if there was a temperature effect and we did the first four experiments on day one and the next four experiments on day two, we're going to confound or confuse the effect of temperature with the changing C. So even though I write down the experiments in standard order, when we run them, you do them, you just use a random number generator in R or MATLAB and you just randomize your order. You flip coins or pick cards or something. Okay. So run your experiments randomly and you collect the results. So after running those four bioreactor runs, we collect yield values of 6960, 6453. Okay. So we've done the design of the experiments, we've executed the experiments, and this is called our log sheet or our run sheet of the data. And then it's really nice to visualize the data in this way. Okay, so let's take a look at what this says. We'll write down the first factor. You don't have to do it this way, but the first factor I usually write on the horizontal axis and then the second factor on the vertical axis. So 69 was recorded for the case when temperature was low and substrate concentration was low. So that goes in the bottom left corner. The second run was at higher temperature, but substrate was still at the lower level of 1.25. Okay, so this is the plus for temperature and the minus for substrate. The third run, or the third recorded data point rather, is 64 for the yield, and that was when temperature was at the lower level and substrate was at high. And then the last run was both at the positive or the high levels. Okay, so if you write it in Yates' order, you'll always find you just write left, right, top, bottom, and you write out your results in a standard way. Okay? Then let's analyze what's called the main effects. The main effect is, what is the effect of changing temperature, and what is the effect of changing substrate? Okay, so going back to this example, or back here, the main effect of temperature, we can estimate in twice. Temperature has two effects, one at the low level of substrate, 1.25 grams per liter, and we also see what the effect is at temperature when substrate is high. So the temperature effect is 60, well, by convention we take the effects to be the difference from higher value minus the low value. So the effective temperature is going from 60 to 69. So increasing the temperature from 338 to 354, in other words, we've gone from here to here, it's a 16 degree increase. That's led to a 9% change in yield, or 9% decrease in yield. Increase in yield, sorry, 60 to 69. Okay? So the main effect of temperature at the low level of substrate is 60 minus 69, so minus 9%. The main effect of temperature at the high level of yield of substrate is 53 minus 64. Okay, so that's, what's that, 13? No, 11. So we've got minus 9% at the low level and minus 11% at the high level. So what would you say is the average effect of temperature is minus 10%. Okay? So the effect of temperature in this experiment is to decrease yield by 10% when temperature increases 16 degrees. Okay? Yeah. Yeah, so if you have replicates, then what we typically do if we have replicate experiments, we'll talk about that in the next class, but usually if we have replicate experiments, we take the averages at each point, and then these numbers would be the average. Yeah. So if you repeated this four runs a second time, the numbers you would work with here are the average of the two. So you have two runs at each point, which is the average. Okay, so similarly, the effect of substrate, we can compute that twice. So the substrate has the effect of going from 64 down to 69, so it decreases the yield by 5% when we increase substrate by half of the liter. So there's a minus 5% change at the low level of temperature. And then substrate, we can also estimate its effect at the high level of temperature. So temperature is held constant here at 354. So we're only, if you want to look at it this way, we're only changing one variable at a time. We're looking at just this aspect. We're only changing substrate. It's going from 53 to 60. So it's a minus 7% change. So each of these, every time we look at an effect, we are actually looking at one variable at a time. So if you want to please your colleagues that way, yes, you want to see it one variable at a time. This is the effect of one variable at a time. Only temperature has changed. But we get two estimates of it. Okay? We're seeing that in here it was a 9 degree change, and here we're seeing it's an 11% change. So we get two estimates of the main effects. And that's what I've shown here in this example. So typically, you'll write it up this way. Once you put your data down in standard form, you can then calculate the main effects. So minus 7 and minus 5 up here would be the effect of changing substrate, and minus 11 and minus 9 is the effect of changing temperature. And I'm just showing you here, this is exactly the same, I'm just showing you what the effect is if we did it from the center, which is where our baseline was. So what is, if we changed over half that range, well, it's just half the effect. I'm just putting it out there for now, and we'll get back to it in a minute while we do that. Okay, so that's what the main effect is. And then if you want to visualize it, I've just shown what the surface plot looks like. So we've changed temperature from 338 all the way to 354. Actually, this doesn't come up very nicely. It's all in color, actually, in the PDF. But the main point of this is to ask, where would you run your next run? Right? So at lower temperature and at low substrate. So that's why we like to see this. I mean, you don't have to plot fancy graphs like this either, but you can see this. You can visually kind of impute what the gradients would look like. The gradients kind of would go along this diagonal direction to show that higher yields are towards this direction. So you would run your next experiment somewhere further down here at even lower temperatures and even lower concentrations of substrate.
Okay, increase if we increase the temperature from 54 by 16 Kelvin, or is that only for that range?
It's for this range, but you can, we're fitting a linear effect. So through that. We don't know any better. We don't know what the non-linearity of the curvature is inside this region or outside it. So we're estimating basically like linear interpolation. We're saying that's the best estimate of the slope we can make.
So if you set that jargon by 16,000, you might not get attention.
Not of 10%. It might be something big or small, but yeah, at least within this region, that is the change. And as this surface plot shows, there is some curvature, okay, but it's pretty linear. So a linear approximation is good. We'll talk about non-linearities again in the next class, but for now, we're just assuming it gets linear. So, good question. Another way to look at this data is you look at the side view of that surface plot. So you can look at just the temperature angle. So looking at it just from this side, you get an estimate along this direction at the low level of substrate and at the high level of substrate. So you get those two lines. And that's what this shows you over here. So when varying temperature from this low level to this high level, you go from 64 down to 53. So let's take a look at that. That's this effect up here. Yield went from 64 to 53. At the low level of substrate, 69 to 60. And the answer we see 69 down to 60. So this is another way to visualize the data. So that's for the temperature effect on the left, and the substrate effect is shown on the right. And I'll just make a note here that the lines are roughly parallel. So you get two estimates of the main effect. That's the key point. Okay, let's just take a 5-10 minute stretch, a leg stretch break, and we'll start again in 4. The main effects are really these two estimates that we get for each variable, so temperature and substrate concentration. We get two estimates of the effect of temperature and two estimates of the effect of substrate concentration. So there was a question during the break on, well, we've done these four experiments. How does it compare to the one variable at a time approach? So the one variable at a time approach would say, here's our baseline operating point in terms of temperature. And here's on this axis, substrate. So there's our baseline point. We would be placing these four experiments kind of around the baseline. That's typically where we do our first run of a design experiment. We do it around the center point. Whereas the one variable at a time approach did the first experiment over here. So the second one was, or the baseline was there. The third experiment over here and the fourth experiment was over there. Just changing the temperature variable. So those four experiments are inefficient in the sense that all you've learned about is the effect of temperature. You've not learned anything about the effect of substrate. So you kind of wasted your budget of four experiments just figuring out about one thing. And also, you've only figured out that effect. The effect of that is just really just that straight line. By doing a design experiment, you've estimated the temperature effect twice, once at the high level and once at the low level of substrate concentration. So you can, and you can average them out to get effect. Admittedly, sure, with the two experiments, you don't have any estimation of the non-linearity of the surface. You can only assume the surface is linear, whereas with the four experiments, you can kind of maybe figure it out, right? And get a better feeling for the non-linearity. But you're only still learning about one thing, temperature. So in that sense, the design experiment, the factorial experiment, is more efficient. You're learning about two factors, and you get to estimate the effects twice. And if we have time again, I'll show that that's actually efficient in the sense that you're reducing the variability of that. Okay, so let's take a look now. Oh yeah, sorry.
Let's see.
Yeah, that's what we're looking at here in this section on interactions. When there's big question, when there's some effect of the one variable on the other. Right. So let's take this experiment. This is a different system. So I'm going to mention that we're going to switch back and forth between these two systems. I can't use the same system to show both concepts. So this is still the same in terms of the variables, still looking at temperature and substrate, but look at the contours, they're different contours to what we had earlier. And the yield values are different levels, so they're in the 70s and 80s, where previously we were in the 60s. So just, we're on a different system, and this is to show the effect of interactions. So quickly calculate here for yourselves on paper, 2-3 minutes, the main effect of temperature and the main effect of substrate concentration, without looking at your notes. Just so that you kind of get a feel for how to compute the main effects. So this is a new experiment at different levels of temperature and substrate concentration, and with different yield values. So calculate what you would estimate the main effect of temperature and substrate. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, you're right. 390, 400 in that temperature. Great. Thanks for coming. So, main effect of temperature. Any numbers so far? 2% and 8%. Okay. So, main effect, delta T at the low level of substrate is 79, 77. So that's 2%. And delta T at high level of substrate is 89 minus 81. Okay, so that's this effect and this effect over here. Effect of substrate. Actually, let me just complete this over here. So that's the average of that is 10 divided by 2 is 5. So it's a 5% change for the temperature going from 390 to 400. Across the full range of temperature. So it's 5 degrees per 10 Kelvin. Okay, so that would be the temperature's main effect. The substrate main effect is the effect of delta S at T at the low level. It is then this change here. 81 minus 77 is 4. And the change of substrate at T at the high level. So the average of that is 70%. Okay. Now what you notice about those numbers within each effect? So let's take a look at these numbers. sorry, this is the effective temperature at the low level of substrate.
Yeah.
Yeah, plus two, yeah. And the temperature, yeah. Yeah, well, this is the, we're saying what is the average effective temperature over the range in which we did this experiment. But your point, you're coming on to exactly this point of the interaction. In the previous example, these two numbers were more comparable. Like they were plus 8 and plus 8, or plus 7 and plus 9. And here we may have had plus 6 and plus 5. Or in this case, we've got this big disparity between the two numbers. Okay? So that's the effect of interaction. The effect of temperature is much greater at the high level of substrate. So the effect of temperature is plus 8 at the high level of substrate. At the low level of substrate, the temperature effect is small, plus 2. It only increases the yield by 2%.
That 5%, would it be per grams per liter, or?
Sorry, yeah. So, and likewise, the substrate concentration, we have a 4% increase in yield at the low level of temperature, but a 10% increase in yield at the high level of temperature. So for both these two variables, there's a...
Isn't it backwards? Because you're changing the substrate concentration, right, at the constant temperature, and then you're changing the temperature at the constant substrate.
So this leads to... Okay, let's see. So the change in substrate at the low level of temperature, so temperature is constant. Temperature is at 390. You're looking at the, it's yeah, good question though. It's gone up. I always get mixed up with all, and I forgot why I wrote the wrong number. Plus 4 increase in yield at the constant temperature. And a plus 10. Okay? So this disparity between the two measurements that we have is given by this idea of interaction. And so yeah, this is still visible here. So if we look at that same effect plot this time, you can see the lines are not parallel. And so that indicates there is some interaction. In some cases, you'll even see the lines crossing. You'll get a plus 8 effect at the high level and a minus 8 effect on the low level. And so you say, well, the average effect is 0. Okay? So you can imagine a case where that could happen, where... where the lines cross like that. Because the slope, the curvature is just totally gone. Like, you have to kind of visualize it, but the system is looped right around. And so you would say the main effect is zero, but the interactions would be huge. In this case, it's moderate interaction. The two lines are non-parallel. Okay, so let's come back to the system with no interaction. We had the change in temperature. This is the earlier example. The change in temperature was minus 11 and minus 9. So those two numbers are similar. And the change in substrate was minus 7 and minus 5. Again, there's no, almost no difference between those two numbers. So when we calculate the average, we're happy with that as being the true effect of temperature and the true effect of substrate. In the system with interaction now, we're seeing the 8 and the 2 and the 10 and the 4 for substrate. So there's some phenomena in the system that we haven't quite captured by assuming this linearity or constant slopes. There's something there that we haven't quite caught in our model. And we'll call this interaction. So the way you quantify it is as follows. Let's just take a look at the first one. The temperature interaction with substrate. Well, that's the change in yield due to temperature at high S. So the change in yield due to temperature at high S. So here's S plus, here's S minus, here's T minus and T plus. So the change in yield due to temperature at the high level of S was plus 8. And the change in yield due to temperature at low S was plus 2. We quantify the interaction as saying it's the half difference from high to low. So we take the difference at high S minus the difference at low S, so that's 8 minus plus 2, and we use half that value as the interaction. Okay? And that comes out to negative 3. That's one way to quantify the interaction. Let me just step back to the system where there was no interaction. Those two numbers would be similar, so when you subtract them, you take the difference at the high level and the difference at the low level, and you subtract them, they'll cancel out. You get an approximately zero number over here. But when there is interaction in the system, you've got these differences that are not similar. So 8 minus 2, and we'll use half that value too, as the... So we get a plus 3. And interactions are symmetrical. If you look at the interaction of substrate with temperature, you're using different numbers, but you must get the same result. So we're saying the change in yield due to substrate, the change in yield due to substrate at high temperature, so on this side of the box, that was plus 10, and the change in yield due to substrate at low temperature was plus 4. So then it's 10 minus 4 and then half that difference, and you get the same result. Yeah, you always will get the same result. So listen. Okay, so this interpretation of the interaction effect is that temperature and substrate will interact in some way to increase the yield by a greater amount when they're larger. We will see this very clearly in the next section. And similarly, both terms reduce when they're both at the low level. I'll come back to a plot of that. Okay, so if we move on now, so I've just stated what the interaction is. Now I'm going to look at how we can model these systems using least squares. So let's go back to this original system with little interaction. Okay? I'm going to define new variables first, and then we're going to build the least squares model. So this is, and I screwed up again. Okay, so this was the low temperature was 338. The high temperature was 354. So in this second column, that should be 338, 354, 338, 354. So just over here. I've got my numbers wrong. So the temperature is wrong, but the substrate numbers are right. So this is just back to the original data set. So what we're going to do is define new variables, and we'll call this a standard form. We say the variable's value, so in this case 338, minus the center point, and we divide it by the range of the range. So the temperature, that would be 338 minus the baseline, 346, so the center, divided by half the range, gives you minus 8 over 8, minus 1. So this new variable, T minus, is... we'll code that 338 as minus 1. Similarly, for the substrate at its low level, we'll get a value of minus 1. Temperature at its high level, we'll get a value of plus 1. And substrate at its high level, we'll get a value of plus 1. The center point, if we had to code the center point in the same way, we'll say center point minus center point, we'll get a 0. Okay, so what we're doing now, then, instead of using, like in this case, it was 338, at the low level and 354 at the high level, we're going to change that to minus 1 and plus 1. For convenience, it matches the standard form of the way we write out these experimental designs, so it's just much easier to work with these standard numbers than we can work with any system in any units. So we'll do that for the factors T and S. And we're going to fit a least squares model of this form here. Y is equal to beta 0 plus the temperature effect, beta T. And XT is going to be that new temperature variable, minus 1 or plus 1. Plus a substrate effect, where beta S is going to be the effect of substrate and times its value of minus 1 plus 1. And then this interaction term, beta Tx. So we have four parameters to estimate. So the estimates are B0, BT, BS, BTS. And we have four data points. So four data points, four parameters. Once we fit the model, there's 0 degrees of freedom left to estimate standard errors and confidence intervals and so on. So we're going to fit four data points to four parameters. We're going to get a perfect fit with no error. And we're going to use, and this is the reason why I looked at the X transpose X matrix in the start of this class. We're going to use that same idea over here. So we've got that equation. We write out the four experimental data points. The first row corresponds to the first condition. Y1 was 69. The slope coefficient has a value of 1 in the X matrix. Then the value of T minus is minus 1. The value of S minus is minus 1. Our first run was done at the low temperature and at the low substrate concentration. So it's a minus 1 for T and a minus 1 for X. That goes into the X matrix. And then the TS product is coming back here to recall why we're doing that, because beta TS is going to measure the interaction, that is a measurement of how X and T, XT and XS, their product affects the Y. So we put the product of these two columns, the second column and the third column, the product of that just goes into the last column. So it's pretty straightforward to construct the X matrix. The first column is due to the intercept. The second column is just a rewrite of your design matrix, minus, plus, minus, plus. The third column comes from the second column of the design, minus, minus, plus, plus. Just coming back to that. So we just really take the signs there, minus, plus, minus, plus. That's the effect of temperature, the effect of substrate, minus, minus, plus, plus. So that's what we just put in here for this second column that corresponds to the temperature coefficient. The third column corresponds to the substrate coefficient. Then the fourth column is just the product of the columns 2 and 3. Okay? What would you estimate X transpose X looks like? If you just looked at that data, or if you had to even calculate it by hand, what would you say X transpose X looks like? Firstly, what would the first column, the first entry in X transpose X, that very top left-hand corner. So this is our X matrix over here. What would the first entry in X transpose X look like? So this is going to be X transpose X. It's going to be... entries, the first one here. Second entry. Zero. Next one. Yep, and so on. The last column. Okay, so the second entry in the second row. Okay, so you kind of see what's going on. What does that tell you about the data? So, what can we infer from this? Does it match with what we know? Transpose X is going to be, remember, it's a measure of the correlation or covariance between the data. So the fact that we are, all our off diagonals are zero indicates that each of the columns are uncorrelated to the others. we can at least expect that from the second and third column, because we're changing the temperature independently of the substrate. Like, there's no relationship between how we move substrate and temperatures. Also, the first column is just a column of ones, and there's no other column that's constant like that. So the first column is also unrelated to the other three. So this is not surprising. Okay. Nor are these two zeros. Those two are expected. And then this last pair just says that this confounding variable, this product variable, is also unrelated to everything else. Right? So this is exactly what we expect. The diagonal entries will be always 2 to the k, because we've got k factors. So if you had three factors in this experiment, this would be a 2 to the 3 factorial. The diagonal entries would only be 8s. So your diagonal is always equal to 2 to the k, and your off diagonals are equal to 0, because each variable in your data is independent of the other. Okay, so x transpose x is just diagonal of the 4s, because x is orthogonal, is another way of saying it. And then x transpose y is a measure of the covariance between x and y. And you can calculate the regression coefficients b of x transpose x inverse x transpose y. So notice x transpose x inverse is this matrix given over here, 1 over 4s. You can know that. You can invert x transpose x by hand when the diagonals, when all diagonals are all 0. The inverse of that matrix is just the inverse of the individual elements of a diagonal. You multiply that with x transpose y, and you get that model over here. Okay, so this is the nice thing about least squares. It's very simple by hand to calculate your model when you've got independent variation in the columns of x. Inverting your x transpose x is trivial. It's the inverse of the sum of squares of each x. Calculating x transpose y is about the hardest thing in this page here. So we get this model then, which says the effect on yield is some intercept term, some base value, minus 5 times the effect of temperature, minus 3 times the effect of substrate, then minus 0.5 the effect of the interaction between temperature and substrate. So, come back to the main effects. Remember what the main effect was for temperature? Was minus 5 cent per 8 Kelvin. Okay, so I'm looking at the half effect. I'm going from here to here was minus 5%, and the effect of substrate was minus 3% for a half a change. The reason why I'm looking at half a change is going to be apparent now. When you look at this number, say Et equals minus 5, it's multiplied by Xt. So Bt minus 5, the effect of temperature. Xt isn't temperature in the raw values, it's actually a normalized temperature. Remember, our x was constructed by saying, let's just go back to that, our x was constructed by saying the variable minus the center point divided by the range of the two. That's what x is. So we can't just say that the usual way of saying it might be that this coefficient of minus 5 is a 1 degree change in temperature. That's not true. Once we've normalized the data, changing x from 0 to 1 implies changing changing temperature from 0 to 1. So 0 was the center point over here. So a change of 1 unit in that new variable xt is a change from going from the midpoint to 354. Okay, so that's an increase of 1 unit in temperature. That's why the slope there is minus 5 per 8 Kelvin, because that changes 8 degrees. It's also the effect of going from minus 1 to 0. That's also a change of 1 degree. So it's the same interpretation. So that's why this minus 5 we get over here matches with the same value we get from these squares up over here. Similarly for the substrate, we get a minus 3xs. and that corresponds to the change of half of the difference in substrate. So the least squares model gets you exactly the same results as the one by hand. And in addition, we also get this interaction term of minus 0.5, where did it go? Over here. So now, relatively speaking, you can see what the interaction is. It's relatively small for this system. Because the data have been standardized or normalized in some way, you can say, yes, temperature has a stronger effect on yield than the substrate does over that for this given range, relative to the given range. And then that interaction term is coded as a number that's either minus 1 or plus 1. So you can then see, well, relative to that, this 0.5 is actually a pretty small interaction relative to the other three coefficients. There's a relatively small interaction effect. Okay, so if you go back to the system with high interaction now, you can then calculate, I'll leave this for you to do at home, you can use the fact the baseline is 395 and 0.875 was the baseline substrate, and you can verify this model for yourself in the same way. Calculate X transpose X transpose Y, calculate E, and you can verify that model. And you'll see there that the interaction effect is pretty comparable to the other main effects. Okay, so the least squares model gets you exactly the same as before. Here's just a little bit of what the interaction is doing. If I drop out the interaction term, it says that there's a linear slope. That's a flat slope between a range of 390 up to 400. That was the range over which we moved temperature. And substrate moved over the range of 0.5 to 1.25. So that's if we omit the interaction term. If you put that interaction term back, you can then see this curvature in the slope. So the effect of temperature is much higher at high level of substrate. So that's, you start lower and you end up at the same point. So that change over there is much greater for temperature. Whereas at the lower level of substrate, the temperature effect is much smaller. So that interaction term brings in some non-linearity there into your system. But that's not really what of interest to us now. I'm just putting it more for interest. Okay? I'm just wondering, okay, I've made this for you to do at home. This is in your notes. I was going to work through this in the class, and I will in the next class. I'll take this up in the next class, and I'll start with this. But what I suggest you do is at home, do the same, but this time the system has three variables. There's a concentration of temperature and a speed variable, CT and S. Okay? So let me actually just kick start it, and then you can answer the rest of those five questions at home. I'll just do the first one with you, and we'll do this in class the next time. But what I'll just show you here is how to represent the data, and it makes it easier for you to get started. Okay, so we have three variables, a C, a T, and an S. The chemical compound is A or B. So that's whether we use compound A or compound B. Is our first factor. Our second factor is temperature. And that is at a low temperature of 72 Fahrenheit, or high is 100. And then we have a third dimension of speed. So we've got the speed at 200 or 400. So the data in standard form. So this is on page 14 in your notes. We've got 5 over here. 30, 6, 33, 5. Okay, so that would be the effect of the y variable. In this case, y is the pounds of pollutant discharged into the river. After treating it with compound A or B at low temperature or high temperature, or at low speed and high speed. Okay. So then you can calculate the temperature effect, the concentrations, compounds main effect, and the speed main effect. Now notice this time when you calculate the main effect, let's say of concentration, there's one concentration effect here at low levels of temperature. There's another concentration effect at high levels of temperature. Then there's a third concentration effect at low temperature but at high speed, and then a fourth concentration effect. So you've actually got four measurements of each main effect, and you average the four. And then you've got four estimates of the speed's main effect and four estimates of the temperature's main effect. So that would be part one of the question, just to put it down geometrically. Before we even go further with the analysis, given that you probably want a low y, what would you already tell someone who's generated this experimental data? What would be the best way to get low y value? Or low amounts of pollutant discharge. Hierarchy, yeah. Great. And would you say there's another factor? Low temperature? Sure. Because low temperature is. So, definitely high RPM, but there's also probably some effect from the compound. At A, you've got low levels along that face of the cube. And there's probably also some interaction between the compound and the substrate, compound and speed, S. So some sort of interaction term there. And in fact, you know, I've given you the least squares model over there. You can just look ahead to that. Yeah, and see that it is a CS main interaction term. So work through those questions there, and then I'll take this up in the next class and move through that. What I'll go through now, just to wrap up, is let's talk a little bit about, just to summarize here, and then just a little bit about the
Thank you.
Okay, so the main reason why we like to use factorial designs is because there's a good visual interpretation of the data, even just when you look at the model printed on paper, and you get a lot of information for very few experiments. We'll also see in the next class how we build up on this. I'll skip this part about here. Then I'll just talk now a bit about the course project for this section. So when we do assignments and we do exam questions on this sort of thing, it really doesn't quite cover the nuances that are come up in design experiments. When we do design experiments on paper like this, we've kind of got the data, the system is artificial, it doesn't mean much to you. With this project, you're going to be faced with questions like, which variables do I use? What range should I run my experiment for? How do I measure my variables? So what you're going to be doing here is you're going to do your own design, your own plan for an experiment. You're going to execute the experiments and write a very short report on it. But the focus is more so to get a feeling for these concepts over which range should you use your X variable. How do you measure your Y variable? Does your design include center points? Do you have time to do a fractional design? We'll see in the next class what a fractional design is. A full factorial, which was the work we covered today, was a full factorial design. What if you hit some constraints, like at the high temperature and high substrate, the system is just not able to run at those levels, so you've got that constraint. How do you handle those randomization and so on? So these are topics that come up in real systems, and it's just to give you a chance to experience that. Now you can do anything you like. You can preferably, what I want you to do is do it on a system that you're really interested in. This is something that related to your hobby, your sport. You can do something related to cooking. Something that you've always wondered about. So here's some examples. Like, how can I get better yield of stovetop popcorn? Or how can I make my pancakes fluffier? But that would be a tough one, because how do you measure your Y zero? You know you can change the flour, the eggs, the sugar, and other ingredients. It's easy to change your X's, but how do you measure your Y? You can look at algae growth in an aquarium, melting ice. These are just examples. You can actually do any system, work with any system you like. And particularly if you get it to overlap with another course or a lab, that's even better, because you get two for one going here. And the thing is, just don't pull an experiment out of a journal or a book and say, this is what your guy did. So you'll have to submit the log sheets for the experiments and stuff like that. The objectives are that you kind of experience those things, but what I want you to do is handle your report in a structured way with these areas where you describe what the experiment was for, which variables you measured, how you controlled the disturbances, and other nuisance parameters, and then provide your experimental log sheets, keeping track of any unusual experimental results. And then just do your analysis of the data, which is really what we covered in the class today, was this step 5. And that's why I want you to do the project, so you get to experience steps 1, 2, 3, and 4. And then how do you relate those results back to your data? So again, you can do this in groups of 1, 2, or 3 people. There's an optional deadline of the 15th of March, not the next class, but the class after that, where you just hand in even shorter than one page, just give me some bullet points that describes your system, the parameters you're using, how you plan to control the disturbances, which design you're going to use, and then I will just give you some verbal feedback or I can email you. So this is just kind of a way for you to be sure that you're kind of heading in the right direction, and maybe I'll have some extra thoughts for you to consider in your experiments. Then the final report is due at the end of the month. Again, like I said, very short, no more than 4 pages, but tendency takes 2 to 7 pages. So again, there's even more examples on the website and systems that people think about, but again, you choose that.